We bring to you the unknown tales from Kolkata with Partharanjan and Swarnali Chattopadhya, who will be in conversation with Shuvaprasanna. Partharanjan has been an active architect professional for more than 25 years. Swarnali is the admin of Pruno Kolkata Golpu Group, which aims at bringing together like-minded people who share the love for Kolkata and its heritage. They will be in conversation with the renowned artist Shuvaprasanna. We welcome them all on stage. This session is brought to you by New Shivam Reality.
Hello. A very good morning to all of you. Though we are a little late today, but we do have a very interesting topic today in conversation with Shuvaprasanna and Partha Babu. It is the unknown tales of Kolkata. So I will request Mr. Shuvaprasanna to start with today's topic.
Actually, art is the most important evidence of civilization. And within art, naturally, the sculpture, painting, and the monuments, architectural forms is very, very important role. And if we think about Bengal, it has long, long history, heritage, and as particularly we are, Partho also one of our member, we are organizing and running the heritage of West Bengal, and that way we are concerned about what is our heritage and how old we are, how golden history we have. That is our concern, and every time we are thinking how to actually preserve our heritage and also the great city, Calcutta. As we know the history of Calcutta, so automatically, though Calcutta is a much young city than other cities in West Bengal, history of built heritage in West Bengal is more than 2,500 years old. Excavations at Chandra Ketu Gaur near Barashat, Mughal Mari, 16th century in East Midnapur, and Jagiv Nagar, 854 AD in Malda has unearthed ruins of ancient civilization dating from 2nd century BC. Under the Islamic rulers from the 13th century and the British rulers from the 17th century, undivided Bengal region became a treasure trove, architectural marvel with varied styles and construction techniques. What is important here is that the basic construction was done by construction workers from Bengal. They started constructing buildings for people from different religion and culture, but gradually transformed them to a hybrid style suitable for Bengal's climate and construction materials. Also, I must mention that because of the advantage geographical position of Bengal, with easy access to both river Ganges and Bay of Bengal, it was a highly lucrative destination for European traders. One by one, Portuguese, Danish, French, and eventually British traders and companies arrived to set up their base here. Some of them soon set up their colonies here, while others limited themselves to just trading, posts, and commerce. Naturally, their presence here left behind traces of their culture and architecture, like churches, monuments, residences, administrative blocks, buildings, which gradually became a part of our shared heritage. West Bengal Heritage Commission, formed under the State Act in 2001 only, has started cataloging its built heritage spread over 23 districts. Funds are being allocated for restoration, and some of these buildings, since its formation, the commission has been actively involved in preservation, restoration, and renovation of important buildings and monuments of four of our colonial past. Recently, in collaboration with the National Museum of Denmark, we have restored and renovated a number of heritage sites in Srirampur, including Danish Government House, St. Olaf Church, etc. Similarly, West Bengal Heritage Commission, in collaboration with the Government of France, is currently in process of restoring and renovating number of French heritage sites in Chandanagar. More importantly, the commission is trying to create an awareness for heritage conservation among the citizens by organizing heritage walk, lecture, workshop, and starting a scholarship program for students interested in specializing in architectural conservation. A large of buildings are being given heritage status all over the West Bengal. The towns of Koch Bihar and Nabodip will be called Heritage Township after preliminary reports and are submitted by IIT Kharagpur and IIST Howrah. A magazine called Oitijho or Heritage, published annually, lists the activities of the commission in the field of heritage conservation. We are publishing books on research funded by our commission. A book has been published on buildings in Bengal where Rabindranath Tagore had stayed and visited. It is a huge task which requires both money and sensitive approach, as heritage conservation has to sustainable in the long run. But most importantly, it needs involvement of the people, because we are trying to preserve a part of our history for our future generation. I sincerely hope that with active participation of the media and increased effort from all of us, we'll be able to achieve what we are targeting. Actually, this is a brief introduction of the heritage of West Bengal, the Heritage Commission's activities. But Kolkata, now I'm sure that almost all you are citizens of Calcutta. You know our history and our architectural heritage. Time to time, various architectural example people established during Babu culture or before, and many other time. Just day before yesterday, we went to see the North Calcutta's most interesting historical example of architecture and the history behind. Now today, that Partharanjan, who is not only a very creative architect, as well as he is a conservator, and he studied conservation, and with the help of Partho, we are time to time organizing workshops, seminars, to just aware our people about our heritage and pride. Now, I think Swarnali also, she is most enthusiastic. They have a beautiful young group who are concerned about Kolkata, and they have a group called Purono Kolkatar Golpo. Apart from their own activities, they are completely involved to just create awareness of Calcuttans about our heritage. Now, Partho, just.
Good afternoon, everybody. It's a pity that West Bengal Heritage Commission is only concerned about our built heritage. We need to go beyond that, because Bengal, as we all know, is has a very rich tradition of culture. There are many aspects, like, you know, music, art, textile, making of musical instruments, so many different things. But conservation and restoration of built heritage itself is a huge task. So far, we have, you know, are concerned only with urban heritage, but if you look at the rural structures, Bengal has a very rich tradition of different kind of rural architecture. We can basically divide Bengal into, you know, four sections, and each region has its own style. We are working all over Bengal, and you see, there's a lot of awareness already existing in other cities and other towns, which makes our work a little easier. Because of the pressure of the developers, it is very difficult to do certain things in a place like Calcutta, or, you know, suburbs of Calcutta. This is because old buildings are difficult to maintain. The main two problems of old buildings are that most of them are tenanted. So therefore, you know, the owner does not have any right, the tenants don't want to restore, they keep on adding, altering, and they destroy the character of buildings.
Lots of litigation.
The laws have to change. We have overlapping laws, which actually does not allow us to, you know, do anything, even though we try. The other thing is, you know, multiple ownership. A building which was owned by a single person or a single family, let's say 200 years ago, is now owned by about 15, 16 or maybe more. Most of them are outside. Calcutta, many of them are outside India. They can't maintain, but they want their share because they don't want to come back. So, you know, the current owners at times do not have any choice but to, you know, break it down. But there is a way. There is always a way. What we are requesting from Heritage Commission to all the builders and all the owners is, you know, heritage conservation is not anti-development. We can keep the building, we can retain the building and yet develop. We are already in dialogue with the development authorities and municipal corporations, and many of them have come forward. They are allowing relaxation if the original building is retained. From Heritage Commission, we have also suggested something called a TDR, which is Transfer of Development Rights. If that is implemented in Bengal, many, many old buildings will be saved. I can explain that very simply. If it has not been enacted as of now, but Transfer of Development Rights means that if you have a building of 10,000 square feet, and if you give it to a developer, he'll be allowed to build, let's say, 50,000 square feet. And he can sell it and they can share the profits. TDR actually allows the owner to sell that extra 40,000 to any developer anywhere in the city. So therefore, he gets the same price. Another developer who's doing another project can buy this 40,000 and he buys at a price. It's a win-win situation because the government gets you know, royalty from their tax and what have you, stamp duty, and the owner also gets his money. The rider is that the old building, the original building, will have to be retained and maintained. If that is implemented, like it has been done in many other cities like Pondicherry, like Ahmedabad, like certain parts of Maharashtra, Bombay, then I think it will be a step forward towards conserving the old buildings. The other thing that we are doing is we are getting suggestions from and proposals from old building owners where there is a fight between the developer and the owner. The corporation has sanctioned a plan, the old building is going to be demolished. What we are offering from the Heritage Commission is we will develop a plan where the building can be, old building can be retained. And leaving the old building, or at least the facade and a part of it, we can create another modern building at the rear side. It has been done everywhere. Recently, I talked to Times of India and I think they published an example of 6th Avenue in New York where the Hearst Corporation had a wonderful building, a six-storied stone building, definitely very, very old, and a wonderful facade. And when they wanted to develop, the architect actually went back 20, 30 feet, retained the entire facade and the front portion, and created a complete steel and glass building at the rear side. Which means that, you know, the memory of 6th Avenue was retained. When we walk inside a city, we have lanes and bylanes, and we have this, especially in a city like Calcutta, we have a very, very strong fabric, the facade of all the buildings together, joined together. They actually have formed something like a memory. That's the memory of our city. We cannot destroy that memory. I'm now talking about precincts and, you know, districts and areas. I'm not talking about individual remarkable buildings, which has been done in many other cities. You know, as tourists, when we travel, when we go to Jaisalmer or Jodhpur, we are actually seeing buildings and facades and areas. Then we go to places like Venice or Florence or Rome, we come across these areas where individually none of the buildings have this remarkable heritage quality or a landmark quality. But as a whole, they present a picture, they tell you about the character, history, what were the workmanships like in those days. So that has been retained and people are reaping benefit from there. And I think Swarnali is an enthusiast. Swarnali will be able to tell you more about her experience of what our efforts are like.
Thank you, Parthada. The thing is that as we are working as a representative of Kolkata, not only the group, because we do have a group of more than 1 lakh people. So we are all Kolkata lovers, we are all heritage lovers, we love our city. But the thing is that we don't know how to do it. Like the what we can do, what's the process, the procedure. What we are trying to do, we are trying to generate the awareness that we are doing. We have recently taken up a case of a school of Metropolitan Institution. We have taken up the case. It's under the trust board. It was getting demolished, but we tried to stop it from the citizens' corner. Now we are appealing to different commissions like Heritage Commission, Heritage Committee. We are going to different areas. So what is the major procedure? Like if the owner, now you said that the owners, they are not like litigated buildings are there. Many a times the owners, they don't want to give. There are a number of problems, we can understand. But there are buildings where owners are not a problem, where the owners, they don't know what to do with the building. So in that case, if the citizens want to take up the case, citizens want to do something, give it back to the city something, what is the procedure? What we will do?
No, that way, first, they have to apply us. Because we can't go and see and take the decision or whatever it is. So if they send us some letter or application that they are thinking about how to conserve that building and etc. Immediately we had a committee and we used to send our expert. We have to see whether there is some court case or litigation, whatever the thing. And after that, we are trying to put first the heritage tag and accordingly the further. Maybe if it is that sort of important, if they think that there is a shortage of money and etc., we also allotted money for that. So every time we are doing, you know that last year, Michael Madhusudan Dutta's place, that actually the property sold to other people. And some local Muslim property owner, they bought that building. And that was before our Heritage Commission rule or whatever. And there is no evidence, even in Calcutta municipality, they have no evidence whether in record there is, some record they need that there was that was a property of Madhusudan Dutta or his father. Yeah, that is true. But you see, as they can't they can't show, and the owner actually he's so much that way confident, they pasted a notice that if anyone can then what to do? We actually just sat with the people and requested, because lastly High Court actually told that whatever the decision of Heritage Commission, that is the final. Accordingly, we sat with them and requested that whatever you do, as I can't do anything, we have no power in that way.
If it is a graded heritage building, so KMC, I think KMC did the grading. KMC, first of all, I want to tell you the difference between West Bengal Heritage Commission and Municipal Committee, Heritage Committee. There are many people, we do have a fuzzy idea about that. Next thing is that when grading is done, so definitely they have gone across the papers and then they declared it as a
grade. But there is also some gap or loophole or whatever it is.
So what the
we also we also, because one thing is, as he bought that property before the heritage declaration, So naturally, what he will do? Actually, there was only instance in Nibedita, Bagbaja, Nibedita Lane, that house, that Chief Minister and Calcutta Corporation bought that total property from the owner. And it's a huge money. That was less than one kata or little bit more. So that way, West Bengal government acquired, and after that they started. Again, there is so many things. Couple of days back, governor actually wrote us that he wanted to build a They wanted to build one auditorium there, but it's impossible. And also, he is actually very much disturbed about the pebbles. He told that instead of pebble, he wanted to just make a concrete thing and etc. No. We can't allow that. We can't allow that.
The change you cannot allow.
We can't, because there is in the west part, west gate, there is a building which maybe during the time of B.C. Roy or something, they added that, where ministers are living. Only I told that if you could demolish that, and instead of that living space, if you could make auditorium, we could allow, because no problem for that. That is not a heritage part of that governor house.
Okay.
So there is so many things going on. Even as I told and discussed that long back, when Gunter Grass was in Calcutta, he used to stay with me, and he was very much interested to see the North Calcutta. I take him to show the whole area. He was so excited. And as per his request, I arranged a meeting with the then Chief Minister, and he told that as his friend is Professor Rao, he was a Chancellor of Germany, and he told that German will give the fund to make a heritage zone in Calcutta. But there is so many litigation. There is, 30, 40 shareholder of a building. Somebody is least interested. Somebody is living in America or Honolulu or whatever it is. He is not interested to sign. But without signature of that whole property owners or shareholder, you can't do anything. So there is so many things. One is that in Germany or in England also, there is a separate rule for heritage building or heritage thing. But here is no such rule and no such money. Because in Germany, I have seen that the outside of the building, they kept as it is, but inside they changed. And there is a special process. That way, Partharanjan Das, like very few conservator and architect, they have clear idea what to do, but we can't touch this way. But really, really, we are interested to keep the glorious past and etc. And another thing, we are always discussing about heritage. But heritage is not only building. We have so many heritage. So many. Bishnupur Gharana or Baluchar, that weavers who are making Baluchari sharis. Yes, yes, there is so many things, but we are limited. We are only concerned about the building.
No, it is not like that, because when you just announce a zone, even in Kolkata, if you announce like Chitpur, when we worked, we found it is not only the building which is making, which is big, it's the common people.
Just
It is the common people, this roadside joints, the lithographs, the jatra, the mishti workers, they all gave the character to that place, and still that old character is there in Chitpur. So why don't West Bengal Heritage Commission, like you said that in Nodia you are doing?
We are only concerned about the buildings.
Not the zone.
Monuments. No.
It's a pity.
Actually, the whole culture or whole our heritage thing is not only the monument.
No.
There's a painting, there's a sculpture, there's a music.
Yes.
There is crafts. Mm. And really the Chitpur, it's an unbelievable place. Every bricks, it has
a story.
Some story. So naturally, what we could do, the awareness. For example, the Times of India, within their literary fest, they have planned about the city, about our heritage. It's a great, this way also many people
It is a kind of awareness. You know? Like Tolig, I'll just congratulate Times Group to select such a place, that heritage place. Now, how many of us know the story of Tolig Club?
Yeah,
that's the awareness.
It's unbelievable, that, unbelievable.
So I'll request you to tell us the story.
A British era,
because it's an unknown tales of Kolkata.
The town hall, everything. There is a huge glory, past glory is there. So naturally, this is the only thing we are really concerned, but common people should come, and also
common people, there are many people who are interested, because Bengali communities, as we know, as we see through our work in social media, that there are many Bengalis outside Kolkata also, but they do have a strong connection with the city. So they want to give back something to their city. It is there in their mind. It is not that they want to do something. So I will request West Bengal Heritage Commission to take the help of the common people also to do something. When you say that there is a problem in like litigation problem, so we cannot do anything. But otherwise. Otherwise, especially in Kolkata at least, if you, West Bengal Heritage Commission is doing extremely good work by doing that heritage work involving so many people, it is a commendable job that they did. But we want them to involve common people more in their work, in their, whatever they want to do, they should extend their hand to the common people. A website should be there.
Yes, we already.
Still now there is no website. So app was done like only 2 days back, one app was done. It's a wonderful app. Through website, we can communicate with you. Otherwise, it's difficult to communicate. Giving information, you need the information, no? That where this problem, like two cannons are lying in a road. Okay, two cannons, they are very old cannons, time from Shiraz Dola, it's lying in a road. Councillor wants to do something, but he don't know the history about it. It's just lying in oblivion. So heritage, in every nook and corner, we find the heritages. Grade 1 building, one Addo Shaddo Ghat, the Rani Rashmoni's Ghat near Nimtala Ghat, it's just lying in such a battered position. So this information also you could take from the people.
No, not only that. If we think about literature, art, or anything, the vibration is coming from heritage. Whether today's discussion with Ruskin Bond, or Shankar, Moni Shankar Babu, or Shirshenduda, or if we think about the other artists and musicians, the many vibration is coming from our heritage. Anthropology, heritage, these are the thing. If you think about Amitabh Ghosh, it's anthropology behind. If you think about Moni Shankar, Koto Ajanare, everything about the heritage stories. So this is the thing. So that way, somehow the Times of India actually planned, thought about this sort of discussion. It is actually one of the most important part of literature or literary fest and it's.
Conservation architecture is a very important part, like in conserving the city's architecture. But what information that we got, that even in Jadavpur University, there is no stream of conservation architecture. So it's such a pity, like Kolkata, like a city like Kolkata with full of heritage, there in the architecture, in Jadavpur University, there is no architectural, conservation architectural like course. Why? Why is it so?
Frankly, I can't answer that question. But it's really a sorry state of affairs that in a place like, not only Jadavpur, but a place like Bengal, in IIT Kharagpur, Jadavpur University, or IIEST, BE College Shibpur, we do not have a course of master's degree course in heritage conservation. Now, we have instituted scholarships for graduate students, people who are interested in fourth or fifth year. If they want to pursue higher studies in conservation, they can go to Delhi or Bhopal or to Ahmedabad or abroad and pursue their, you know, specialization in conservation. But we have to talk to the vice chancellors and we have to talk to the directors of these institutes and really think about, you know, constituting a master's degree course. We thought about, you know, getting a short course, but that does not help because unless we are affiliated to an university, we cannot offer a course. What we do now is we conduct workshops every 3 to 4 months. We get one or two speakers from outside. They tell us their stories, their experience. They show us what they have done all over India, conservation projects. And we get an expert who is an expert in one particular material, like lime or brick. And they tell us how to, you know, study and how to conserve with lime or brick or these old materials. So these workshops are important. We have already set up a lab. We have all the ingredients, but you know, there are laws. We cannot offer any course unless these are taken up by universities. We don't know what to do. I mean, we really need qualified conservation architects. There are about 5 or 6 in our city.
Yeah, because when we tried to contact, and they are so busy, we could not contact them also because there's so less number of conservation architects. Even the young ones like Komolika and all, they're always abroad. They're not here in the city. So I think the young generation, they should take up this course.
But still, if you visit Srirampur.
I'm requesting everyone who are interested, please visit Srirampur. It's so well done, the conservation part. It's really, really remarkable. And that way we are trying more. And
we have
because fund is very important. And recently, as I mentioned that Chandan Nagar, we are trying to negotiate our, you know, interaction with French consulate and French ambassador. They are also very much interested. But it's a huge money involved. We already marked about 8 buildings and we'll put the heritage tag and gradually we'll try to conserve it with the help of them. Yeah.
But we need to change our laws.
From our government, it's not that possible to spend so much money.
And Shubhada, we need to change our laws. There are many problems which is faced by West Bengal Heritage Commission. Yes, just give me 2 minutes. You know, when we conserve or restore a building and hand it over to the owner, what happens after that? You know, the owner does not have the resources or wherewithal to, you know, maintain the building. 4 years down the line, he comes back and says that, you know, we don't have money, we want more money to restore. That cannot happen. We are spending public money. So we have already talked to the tourism department that in certain cases, they can, you know, go to with a sharing mode with the owner and convert some of these places into heritage tourism. But it's not possible to do all the buildings like that. So that is a problem. The other thing is that we really need to change our laws. I mean, we wanted to declare certain areas in Vishnupur town as a heritage zone, and therefore we cannot allow any new buildings to come up. Now the thing is that, you know, these lands are owned by certain people. We cannot suddenly impose this restriction. What will we do with their land? The land will become, you know, of zero value. So they will have to be provided with certain incentives, or we'll have to buy this land from them, which is not possible. So therefore, you know, we really have to think and discuss and conduct seminars and quickly come up with, you know, ideas as to how to change our laws, how to incentivize these things. I mean, we have to control what will come upon those lands. And unless we do that, I mean, nothing can change. I mean, places like Jalpaiguri, places like Kuchbihar, we have to declare a heritage zone where no new construction will come. Otherwise, we cannot do it. And enacting these laws are very difficult. Any law can be challenged. If we infringe upon the fundamental rights of people, that I have a land, I have a property, I will sell it, and I want the money, and I want to go and stay abroad with my son, how will another law stop it? We have to think about those things.
There's a question from my another admin of the group. Is there any possibility of restructuring the heritage list of Kolkata? What is there in the graded list? Is there any possibility of changing?
Yes. I personally do not agree to that heritage list. I know for a fact that initially about a list of 2,500 buildings were given to Calcutta Corporation Heritage Committee, and for whatever reason it came down to about 800 odd buildings. And I think in Calcutta, a place like Calcutta, it can be more than 2,500. Now how to grade these buildings? There is a definite guideline by UNESCO that is to have, it will have to have some architectural character representing some time or whatever materials. It will have to have some kind of history associated with. There are places like Jallianwala Bagh where it is only an open field, it's not a building, but it's heritage because of something which happened there. So there are guidelines by UNESCO. If you follow the UNESCO guidelines, you will see that the grading which has been done to Calcutta buildings are all wrong. There are wonderful buildings where we conducted, day before yesterday we conducted a heritage walk, we went around buildings. There are wonderful buildings which are graded as Heritage 2A. But there are absolutely insignificant buildings, even though old, on Strand Road. 165 Strand Road is one such case, where it's a double-storied building, absolutely broken down. I mean, I don't know for what reason that is grade 1. Now there are grade 1 buildings like the Kenilworth Hotel and many other buildings like the Dunlop House which can be pulled down, which can be broken, but other buildings which are heritage grade 3 cannot be touched. So these things will have to stop, and I think very soon what we will have to do is West Bengal Heritage Act 2001 actually empowers us to work all over West Bengal. So Calcutta Corporation should think of, you know, abolishing their Heritage Conservation Committee. It will do a lot of good to the heritage buildings in Calcutta.
Yes, because since it is almost, it's not there. Actually, whenever we go, it's not there. So it should be restructured or should be done in a different way. Like from our group, we can say, like from the Common Citizens Forum, we can say that we are very thankful that you are organizing such thing. You are interested in doing some work in Kolkata also. We want to give you two proposals. One is to have a heritage atlas, because atlas or small maps at least, because maps, in this walk only we introduced one, like in your folder also there was a one map. Map helps you to identify the building. Then common people, they can see that which buildings are graded and what not. At least they also take up some responsibility in doing something. So if you can do that, like every precinct, every zone, if they have a map, and if you can create a heritage atlas, if you want any help from us, we are ready to help. And second is that grading structures, if you can see to it, because there are beautiful buildings, as Gurupada Halda's building is a very unfortunate example, which happened here in Kolkata. When we went there, we found it is not graded. Why is it not graded? We don't understand that. Because it's a lovely architecture with physical, with cultural, every heritage is attached with the building. But somehow, it's not graded. Why is it not graded? So we want to like appeal before you, just restructure the great buildings.
I think that is what is the
thank you. We have many things to do. Kichu bolben? Eh, bolben bol. Hey,
Actually, I had been hearing to the discussion, and it's more of we can't do certain things here, and unfortunately we can't do. So I was just thinking of some suggestions. One is the law in West Bengal can't be too different from laws in the other states of India. And as I can see in South India and West India, heritage conservation, heritage tourism, these things are much more developed than in West Bengal. So maybe we can borrow some ideas from them, how they had bypassed those laws or how they managed to change those laws, one thing. And the other thing, you know, there are different types of tourists, and the normal tourist in case of Calcutta, for example, would just see Victoria Memorial and Science City and Howrah Bridge and all. But there are other more more intelligent tourists who would go to North Calcutta, who would like to have a taste of the ambience there. And such kind of tourists, often from Europe, they would like to go and live in the even dilapidated areas. So I have a book called Moroccan Living or Moroccan Lifestyle kind of thing, where I found that the dilapidated old quarters of the cities of Morocco, which were deserted by the new elites who were, you know, like French influenced, to move into the European style new areas, and the old areas getting neglected, these Europeans, mostly Europeans, maybe from other parts of the world also, the developed world people have come, they have restored some of the old houses in these dilapidated areas, and they are actually living. And tourists who are more intelligent, they would also move into those areas and see those houses. Now, I have found that in Calcutta, one such building in North Calcutta has been purchased and has been converted into a hotel. It's called the Calcutta Bungalow. But what has happened is the interior is not representative of what actually the house decorations had been. And similarly, the Rajbari of Bawali has been also restored. And if one compares that with the Moheshganj Balakhana estate property, one sees that what is a real heritage building and what has been made into a heritage property, the decor is lacking the proper ambience. So some kind of people should be there who we can invite, who would study the proper ambience of those days and can decorate properly. And then these people can buy the old property. And I think even though people are divided, the owners are divided into some other kind of thing, when a lot of money will come, they will all be united. So we can change, make some heritage hotels in the North Calcutta zone.
Actually, rules, laws in other states are different. In Pondicherry, for instance, there's a zone where you cannot alter the elevation without specific permission from the municipality. In Ahmedabad, there are very strict laws. In Bombay, there are other laws. I mean, these laws are there. So it's not that the law is the same. If you look at, when you talk about restoration and whether the interior is retained as an authentic interior, that is purely the prerogative of the owner or the person who has bought it. I think one of the best examples we cited a few years ago was Neemrana Fort. I've actually gone and lived in Neemrana Fort, and I think they have destroyed the main character of the fort. That was not the Rajasthani hill architecture. They have actually started, they have gone overboard actually, built too much. And the kind of, you know, facilities, like there are swimming pools at three levels, and these things will happen. I mean, after all, they are hoteliers. It is good that they have taken over a fort and the fort has survived. But even in Calcutta, if somebody buys and changes, I mean, we want the building to survive. I mean, we can cannot be, you know, very picky.
They are
about
interested to how make money and how they will run that. So that is their criteria. They invested maybe crores of rupees. That is the thing.
No,
and you can't compare with Morocco, because that Morocco's ruler, Morocco's population, and Calcutta, it's very, very difficult. And lots of, which I already explained, the lots of litigations, lots of shareholders, the owners. So how we could that way manage and etc.
I also feel that, you know, Calcutta's main problem, and what is the difference between Calcutta and many other cities and towns in India, is if you take North Calcutta, more than 50% of people staying there are not Bengalis. They come from other states. Yeah. They do not have a sense of belonging. They don't have, you know, any love for the building and the envelope that they occupy. So therefore, they keep destroying, they keep adding, they do whatever they like. They are mostly tenants. They pay a paidly sum of money at places. I have seen that people pay 100, 200 rupees rent. They don't feel that it is wrong. So therefore, this is not there in any other city. In any city you will go, starting from Shahjahanabad in Delhi to Old Delhi to Ahmedabad to Pondicherry, wherever, most of the people staying there belong to that region. So they have a sense of belonging, they have a sense of pride, which is missing in most of our old precincts in Calcutta.
That's true. We had the partition and post-partition problems. But maybe
it's not partition. It's not partition. It's from other region from India.
No, I know. But that would be true of Bombay also.
I should not
Bombay
be talking
also.
Like this. It's unparliamentary. But you know, there are people from other regions of India.
No, but that should be true of Bombay also, I guess, right?
No, it's not. It's not. They have a sense of belonging. They have a very strong sense of pride and sense of belonging. It's not true for Bombay.
But the thing is that the new generation, if they are not aware of it, like even for the Bengalis, okay, I'm not talking about non-Bengalis, even for the Bengalis,
yeah,
if we
true.
Are not teaching in the school, if we are not starting it from the grassroots level, how those children will be related to Kolkata? They are going outside. Most of the, you will find more Bengalis outside nowadays rather than in Kolkata. So anyways, we want to wrap the this discussion. Just one question, if you want to have one or two questions from the audience. Okay, so thank you.
One can see that their heritage suddenly being taken off the list without anybody's knowledge. I mean, without the common people's knowledge, without being told why it is being taken off, without citing a reason, without a counter argument being placed, and then you see that building is gone. Recently I was driving by Vivian Brahmachari's house,
yes.
And I see that is going to change. So how is this happening, and can West Bengal Heritage Commission do something about it?
Unless, you see, on our own we cannot act. I feel that it is wrong. There is a process. If you want to delist a building, then the reasons will have to be listed, and one should make an advertisement in the papers saying that this is what we are going to do. If you have any objection, please come forward. And normally that is what we do from Heritage Commission. We don't delist. But even when we list buildings, notice is printed in the papers, and people are given about a month's notice to come out with their objections or suggestions or whatever. But I strongly feel that, I'll again say that the system of listing and delisting by Calcutta Corporation is all wrong.
Okay, thank you so much, audience, for patiently hearing us. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.